And now I need to kind of clean up because I was pulling things frantically to get to the fabric, and I've got now like 2 wigs at my feet. I got a pillowcase over here. I'm just like falling apart. Please excuse me while I shove my fabric away. Woo! What wigs did I manage to tumble out? I don't even know anymore. Oh, well, one of them is Amidala. I'll eventually finish that. At least it's straightened. And then Cersei's down there. Okay, I'm good.
So I have a little bit of a cosplay pet peeve, because if you guys remember, in a previous episode, we talked about cosplay pet peeves in the after session. I found another one.
Shoot.
It's actually really hard for me to find pet peeves. So when I was hunting for patterns in Joanne's, when I was looking for, you know, all my friendly cosplay by McCall's patterns, I realized that every pattern they make has the same basic hourglass women's figure that they use for average that hasn't changed in years. And it's like, how many women at this point are the exact hourglass that they base everything on anymore? I patiently await the day when we have pattern kiosks in Joann's where they don't prepackage them like this anymore. You go into their pattern kiosk, you choose your brand, you enter in your basic measurements, even if it's just the big three, the bust, the waist, the hips, and then it prints out the correct like base figure pattern for you. So if you're an apple shape, you tell it, I want an apple shape pattern. If you're a pear, you tell it, I want the pear shape. If you're a rectangle, you do that. If you're an hourglass, then you can have these. But it would be really awesome if they offered patterns that were more suited to different, I think they're called isomorphs, the different body types, so that you didn't have to Frankenstein patterns together with different sizes and different parts of the pattern so that it suits your body shape. Because I'm not always an hourglass. Sometimes I'm just more rectangular because my weight changes. It would be really helpful if I could just print off a pattern and go, give me this one. And then it just prints it for you in store. And not only does it print it for you on really nice tissue paper, it puts it in the envelope for you. So it all fits.
Now, I don't know about the fitting of the envelope thing, but you might want to patent that idea.
It's on the interwebs. I own this.
You own this. So it's 6/21/19 at 8:15 p.m. Central Standard. Where are we, Central Standard Time right now? Or CDT? Central Daylight Time, because daylight savings, it's annoying. 8:15 p.m. Central.
Well, see, a machine had to stuff this in the envelope in the first place.
That's a good point.
The little pattern kiosk can at least put it in there the first time. And then once you pull it out, it's on you to put it back in the envelope.
At that point, you're on your own, man.
Exactly. But I will say that having the larger envelope sizes, it's much easier to put back into the envelope.
Right?
Even though the pattern pieces that are inside are the same size as the standard smaller envelopes. So it's much easier to keep it in this size envelope. So kudos on you, McCall, for that.
Yeah, Laughing Moon, who does a corset line, they have large envelope sizes too. And I'm glad I got my one corset pattern, like, well, two patterns I actually have, fits super nicely in that huge ass envelope. I really appreciate that.
I have half a mind to just go start purchasing manila envelopes.
Yeah.
Cut the front off of the McCall pattern or the Simplicity pattern, stick it on the front, cut off the back with the measurements, stick it on the back, and then have a larger envelope in which to put my patterns. I have
not a bad way to go.
Because it gets really tiresome sometimes folding them and trying to get them back in the envelope without ripping them because, of course, tissue paper is somewhat frail.
Yeah, I'm actually pulling one of these now. I'm not going to be able to show the front of it because I think the person may be watching and I don't want to give away the gift, but one of my cross-stitch kits came in one of these and it fits really, really nicely. It didn't have a hoop with it, which is probably why it was okay to ship it this way, but everything fit in really nicely and I was able to shove everything back in without a problem. So, you know, if it works, it works. Don't knock it.
Yep. So think about that, pattern manufacturers. Slightly larger envelopes. Yes, it will cost slightly more in materials, but they're a little bit more reusable.
We would appreciate that immensely. We like reusing stuff.
I mean, I'm willing to toss in an extra dollar or two to have a decent-sized envelope.
It makes up for it.
Yes. Because most people I know who have patterns keep them for years and years and years and years and years.
Because there's something that you can reuse multiple times on multiple projects.
As long as you keep it nice, you know, take care of your pattern and don't just, you know, toss it around, then yeah, it'll last you a long time, even on tissue paper.
But yeah, back to your pet peeve, I would have to agree with you on that because I am more of an hourglass shape, but the reason I don't utilize a lot of the patterns that are available, none of them fit me. I have to do really weird moving of stuff around and shifting to get something remotely close to my shape, and even then, it still does not work. It's so much faster and easier for me to draft my own patterns than to try to make a commercial pattern work because it never works. It never fits properly, no matter how hard I try.
I finally found, and I used the shirt pattern that I was talking about when we were at CCon. That is the first pattern that has fit me without alterations.
Nice.
That's the first time I haven't had to move seams around, which is actually really hard to find because, like Val, commercial patterns don't generally fit me. Yes, I hoard them, but I have to do a lot of alterations to those patterns generally. I can't just use them out of the package.
It's hard to do that sometimes, and that's the only reason why I promote and praise Laughing Moon is because that corset design, I didn't have to make any adjustments to it. I was able to cut it straight out as it was, and it fit me perfectly first time. I was shocked that that worked so well.
Alan notes he keeps his hand-drawn pattern designs in manila envelopes. If they would fit in my paper ream box, I would be more prone to using them.
Yeah.
The smaller envelopes do happen to fit much better in the paper box.
We just need to upgrade you to the 11 by 17 paper boxes.
The problem is I have one. But I stand the patterns upright. So that they're like, oh, what did they call those? Card catalogs in libraries.
Okay.
Of course, all of the younger kids watching these won't even know what a card catalog is from a library because nobody looks up library entries on index cards anymore. They have computers for that now.
Dewey Decimal? What's that?
They still use Dewey Decimal even with the computer. Thank
They
you very much.
do. They do. Thank goodness. I'm sure most kids have no clue, though.
Look it up. You have the internet in front of you guys.
Google.
Or search engine of choice.
Oh, Alan said he uses those old card catalog drawers. That's actually a good idea because I was thinking you could probably get one of those really, get this at a container store for less than $5. They do have those bins that are tall enough for those big manila envelopes that you can use to stand them up all the way.
I think I'm basically going to need a banker's box.
Probably, yeah.
'Cause those are the ones that hold the records.
Really tall records.
Yes. Now I just have to find a place tall enough in my closet to hold that box.
You'll figure it out. It's fine. I have faith in you.
Either that or I may just need to store my patterns flat down instead of standing up. It's just easier to riffle through them if they're standing up because I can see what's on the cover.
Sure. I mean, that makes a lot of sense, especially if you go through them often enough. You got to do what's convenient for you.
Because it's
Yeah.
either that or I'm just going to have to start building an index, like a little catalog of all the patterns I have, and just go, okay, what box did I store this particular design in?
Is it in box one, box two, box 25?
Oh no, there won't be 25.
Yet.
Not unless they were really tiny boxes. Each of those boxes can actually hold a decent number of patterns, at least in the small envelopes. I don't know so much about the manila envelopes.
See, do you have the 8.5 by 11 paper boxes?
I have the 11, in fact, I'm staring at them because they're directly across from me. I have 11 by 17.
Okay, so it's the bigger ones. Okay.
Yeah, it's the double ream, the one that
Yeah.
has two sets next to each other. Yeah.
I know my paper.
Office supplies.
Used to hawk it, so I know my paper.
And yes, storage is always the issue. Need more space.
There is never enough space, especially when you're a crafter. It doesn't matter what your crafting is, you do never have enough space.
Not just storage space, but working space.
I wish I had a bigger work table, but I don't have the space for that. I have what I have, and it's just going to stay this way.
All crafters need a TARDIS so that it's larger on the inside, but it doesn't take up very much space when you store it.
I need a TARDIS, and then I need a Mary Poppins bag. If we can get a combo of the two, I would be really happy.
I just want a Star Trek replicator so that whenever I need something made, I can just ask it. Whether it's food, whether it's a 3D printed piece, whether it's some more of a certain type of adhesive that I just ran out of, whatever I need, replicator.
Just magic.
Yes, I can ask for my caffeinated drink, and then I can ask for a dust mask so that I don't have to inhale what I'm putting together. Then I could ask for more adhesive when I need it. And oh, hey, I need this very specific color of spray paint. Hey, could you mix that for me? Yeah.
Done.
It would solve so many of my problems.
That's probably not going to happen in our lifetime.
But it's nice to
Maybe
dream.
it's a nice dream. Maybe, 3D printers will get to that point before we hit our graves.
No. But we may have 3D printed graves by that point.
I want my tombstone to be 3D printed. Here lies the maker. She loved craft foam.
My tombstone isn't even going to be in the shape of a tombstone. It's going
No.
to be the spool of thread and the needle.
Maybe I'll take the pin that I have. It says fabric hoarder.
There you go.
Oh, so speaking of 3D printing, this is an unintentional segue, but this popped into my head. I've seen more cosplayers talk about this on the contest scene about scrutinizing 3D prints more. In the sense of making sure people are not only creating their own 3D prints, but modeling their own 3D prints. Because they're starting to penalize people for buying patterns online and then just using those patterns to 3D print. And I'm kind of surprised by that.
I disagree with it.
I do too. Because modeling is really hard. It is not something you could just pick up overnight and like, oh, I know how to model. My brother does it for a living and he is constantly learning new things and he's been at it for almost a decade.
3D modeling or just modeling in general isn't like sewing where it doesn't change much over the years. Like sewing now is pretty much the same as sewing 50 years ago. We didn't have 3D modeling 50 years ago.
No.
So it's not like you can just go to YouTube and just go tutorials like you can with something like sewing, with something like wig crafting, something like makeup. There's pretty general beginner-like tutorials, one-on-ones on that stuff. Not so much on how to model your own prints. It also takes a very different sort of spatial ability that not everybody has. I know that I'm not really all that good at it.
And that's my big problem too, and why I don't do any type of like digital work is I can't think in that mindset. I'm good at photoshopping, I'm good at making things flat, I'm good at editing, but moving things into a 3D realm is something that I just cannot do. It's why I suck at making props and armor. I just can't do it.
It's also not as accessible. The software is usually not free. You need a certain type of rig to do it. In other words, you have certain
Yes.
minimum hardware requirements for a PC. You can't just pick up any PC and do it. Whereas if I'm sewing, I can pick up any sewing machine and I can sew. I can sew a straight line and I can sew a zigzag, and that's all I need to make pretty much any costume. You can't really do that with a computer. And you can't do that with just the average piece of software. So it's not really necessarily as accessible to someone who's just starting out in cosplay.
And I think it also kind of shorthands the people who take the time to properly finish the 3D print, to sand it, to prime it, to paint it, to give it the detailing, to give it the cool colors. Because there's something to be said about the people who really craft those 3D prints to make it not look like it was 3D printed, to make it look close to life. That takes an immense amount of time and work that you cannot do just by pushing a button on a 3D printer.
I would think that as long as your cosplay is not entirely built just around that 3D printed part, it should pretty much be considered an accessory just like anything else. Did you make your wig? Probably not. Did you
Right?
make the shoes that you're wearing? Probably not. I mean, not everybody has to make every single thing, like literally from the ground up, like you grow the seeds that make the thing. I don't think we have to get to that level. Competition shouldn't be that buried in minutia.
Exactly. I look at it as it's no different than buying a pattern for a coat from the store and using that as your template. So why can't I do that with the 3D model print? Use that as my template, have it build the piece, but I'm having to still do everything else on top of it. I have to buy the filament. I have to sand it down. I got to do all the other steps that follow it. It's not like, here's the pattern. Oh, cosplay done. I don't understand why that would be so much more scrutinized versus just taking a pattern from a store to make a coat.
As crass as it sounds, I mean, what are they going to do next? Penalize people for using patterns at all? Are they going to force everybody to draft their own?
Mm-hmm.
That's not a skill that everybody has because, again, it's a very different spatial mindset to do tailoring, like actual tailoring. It's difficult. And I don't think that we should be judging on that kind of level, especially if you yourself don't necessarily do it. I don't know. I think that it's kind of getting to the point where the focus seems to be more on the components that go into the cosplay rather than the whole creative approach to the cosplay.
Yeah, that can be very challenging. Alan brought up some questions and I wanted to answer them because some people came up with some good ideas with this. Mm-hmm. His questions are, how would they verify 3D modeling, require the models to be submitted? Do they want to see hand-drawn patterns? What I've seen some people suggest is if you design the model yourself, you put your initials, you put your name or your cosplay handle somewhere on the prop or the piece and have that printed out as well. And that acts as your signature. So that way you can say, yes, I did actually model this. Here's my signature on it.
So basically, like, not to get into the dregs with this, but in answer to the question, no, you can't verify it.
There really is no way to verify it at the end of the day.
I can put someone else's signature on my prop. I can hand somebody else's hand drawing to you. I can put my name into the 3D model and I can submit it as if I did it myself. There is no way that you can verify that.
You just have to kind of hope that they're telling the truth on it. And
honor system.
It's a lot of it really, and that's what most of cosplay competition is the honor system. Though over the years, as judges, we've gotten to the point of realizing, you know, you bought that costume. We can tell. We know the signs now that it's so easy. And we're getting to that point with the 3D stuff too, because so few people do it. We kind of already know people's signature and styling when they make, oh yeah, I've seen that Borderlands gun before. That's from so-and-so person. I know exactly where that's from.
Or that so-and-so blogged about it as they were making it.
Exactly. So it's we know that 3D printing is such a specialized, finite skill. The chances of you modeling it yourself are going to be kind of slim. And it's not to dismiss the people who do actually model their stuff. Yes, they should get the credit for doing all that work, absolutely. But we shouldn't dismiss other people for taking the time to set up the print and to make the piece from all that work, too. That should not be trivialized because that's a lot of work they have to do, too. Why would they spend all that time 3D printing it when they could have made it out of Avafoam? It would have been so much faster and so much cheaper.
I mean, there are still people who try and pass off other handmade commissioned goods as their own in competition.
Mm-hmm.
There's not really a way that you can verify unless you happen to know who made it originally, if it wasn't that person. If you don't know, just kind of got to take their word for it. And that's with any sort of competition like this. We're basically just taking their word for it.
You have to hope everybody plays on the honor system. When it comes down to it.
Were there other questions besides that? You'd said that there were multiple.
Oh, that was all in one chunk from Alan. Let's see. Alan, I've added letters to patterns before printing for some other ID. So there you go. Totally doable. And then Jeresh commented, people trivialize the amount of work it takes to do all that prep work just to print it. Yeah. Because it is a lot of printing. And if you mess up that print halfway through, oh man. That's filament out the window.
Mm-hmm. And you still generally, if you want to enter that into competition, there's a lot of finishing that goes on. If you guys have never seen a raw 3D print, it looks raw.
It's not pretty.
You can tell that that thing just came out of a printer. The surface is roughened. You can actually see the layers from it building up as it went. And there may be imperfections in it in some places. And so there's a lot of cleanup that you have to do to that piece before you even go to assemble it. So a lot of work both on the modeling side and on the cleanup side.
But yeah, just found that to be kind of interesting that that was a discussion point. I was like, oh, I hope that this is not a continuing trend, because that's not going to, it's definitely going to limit the number of people who will be invested in doing cosplay on a contest level, because it's basically going to set the barrier of, okay, if you don't make everything from scratch, then you shouldn't bother entering. And that's not what cosplay contests are about. It's never been about that.
It's cosplay.
Yes, on that play.
Keep the play, keep the performance, the creative aspect in the competition. Otherwise, it's a costuming contest. It's not cosplay. It's costuming. And then you have to start asking people whether they wired up those LEDs themselves, and whether or not they programmed that circuit themselves.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, hey, did you happen to teach yourself the programming it took to actually make that thing do the pattern of lights that it's doing right now? No? Okay. Points taken off because you didn't teach yourself programming. Seriously, guys, like, that's ridiculous.
And let's be frank, like, even if you were a teenager and you have all the time in the world to do whatever you want and learn whatever you want, it's not something you can pick up just like that. It's not something that you can easily learn overnight. It takes time to study these things. That's what boggles my mind.
If you know all the things, you may not necessarily have the time to do it yourself, or you may not have the money to do it yourself. Or even if you had both of those things, you still have to actually go and procure all of those materials and then sit down and do it. And life gets in the way, as we all know.
Everything takes time in some form or another. It's I have respect for the people who have the ability to make those things and do those things and to do the modeling, but I also know that most of those people are in computer animation. They've trained for this, so they already know what to expect going into it. This is their job, and they transitioned it into their hobby on top of that.
Yep, or they do, you know, say they are one of the master prop makers for a movie set if they make maquettes for a living.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, they probably have experience modeling things in software and making 3D prints. Yeah.
It's definitely cool, but I would hate to see that become the factor in deciding, you know, here's who wins cosplay contests, here's who doesn't win. Oh, you didn't make that model yourself, and you don't get the points. It should not be like that. It should never be like that. That really worries me.
I think it would create a lot of uproar in the community. And I think fewer people would enter that contest, because basically you would be setting it. It would be kind of like the whole S-class prom thing, where only certain cosplayers of a certain level can even ponder entering. We don't want competition to be like that. Competition should be open to everybody. And if you happen to have those skills, great. You know, we'll give you points for it. But somebody else shouldn't lose points because they didn't. I think we've kind of beaten this topic to death.
We have. It was unintentional, but it was just like, because you mentioned 3D printing, I was like, oh, hey, I was reading the stuff.
We haven't even gotten to 3D printing fabric yet.
The times be changing.
Did you make that scale mail yourself? No, I 3D printed it myself. Have you ever made ring mail? Chain mail? Come on, guys. If you haven't ever made chainmail yourself, 3D printing it is a cakewalk in the park compared to having to assemble all those rings together.
I now know how to do the 4-in-1, though.
I would give major props to somebody that sat there and made their own chainmail. Is it hard? No.
No.
Does it take a lot of time?
Yes. It takes a lot of time.
That's dedication, you guys. Mad props to those people.
Right.
All right. Well, I think we have definitely cleansed our soapbox.
Ah. We're good for another week. Or another 2 weeks, I should say.
2 weeks. Indeed. All right. Well, with that, we will call an end to this Aftersession for episode 191 of CosPod, the podcast for all things cosplay. If you guys have your own pet peeves about competition, or if you have an opinion about how 3D printing should be involved or not in competition, please feel free to join the discussion that we're having on any of our social media, which you can find here.
And back to Amber.
Including in our Discord channel. And of course, you can always email us your opinion. We are at podcast@cospod.org, where you will promptly get a response from each of us. Because we're very opinionated people when it comes to 3D printing and competitions, apparently.
Unintentionally so, sorry.
But otherwise, we hope all of your 3D printing is going well. We will wish you guys happy cosplaying and see you next time in episode 192. Bye-bye, everybody.
Bye, guys!